I just wanted to welcome everyone for coming here this evening. This is the end of Women's History Month, and I thought it'd be appropriate to get all of the department heads, the female department heads, our male counterpart and department heads. I see we have the police chief here supporting us. Thank you. Female elected officials, I know many of them are on break right now because the Board of Supervisor break, but I did see the sheriff here. Oh, there is Supervisor Fuhrer. Thank you, Supervisor Fuhrer, for showing up today. I know we had the sheriff here earlier, but I thought it was important that we have a celebration to honor Women's History Month, and the mayor had discussed this with me a while ago. And it's also in the, we had a successful 2016 Bury a Woman Summit. And one of the things the mayor said to me right away when he asked me to chair the Women's Summit was, I want to make sure that we have a Women's Summit that is just not inspirational speakers, although that's very important, but we have a policy agenda and we have action items that will continue throughout the years following that Women's Summit. And as it was a very successful one, and as a result, we wanted to come today to talk about what we've done over the last year and what we plan to do in the future. And so thank you, Mayor Lee, for encouraging myself and working with Mayor Schaaf over in Oakland and many of the women here in government in pushing forward all these issues that are not just women's issues, but family issues and equal pay issues. So thank you very much. We'll have a panel discussion with some very dynamic ladies and a reception to follow. So I want to have Mayor Lee come up to talk about some of the things that the city committed during the 2016 Women's Summit and how we are and what we plan to do going into 2018. And I want to just say turn it over to Mayor Lee.
Well, thank you, Naomi, and congratulations on your second term as City Administrator. You know, when you have a good thing going and you find talent, you want to repeat it over and over again. That's why I'm really happy to speak here for a moment with a lot of our women's leadership or leadership in the city. I was just laughing a minute ago because it was very symbolic when I had when we saw Frances holding the ladder as the photographer was climbing up the ladder. That was pretty symbolic. And it's been a good week. So far, and I know that all of you have been paying attention to everything that's going on in our country, and yesterday was yet another moment where we celebrated with our former candidate for president, our Secretary Clinton, at the Professional Business Women's Conference in California, and that was a wonderful time to see over 6,000 professionals come together and talk about what we need to do and do together. I'm very proud of what we're doing right here in San Francisco, and I'm honored to join all of you tonight to celebrate Women's History Month. And I know that Naomi said it was the end of the month. I think it's the beginning, you know, of a lot of good things that we're doing. And everything seems to me to be these days more of a renewance and a beginning of more things to come. And I want to also acknowledge how that this celebration is really happening in a different backdrop than in past years, and certainly since we met in 2016 as the Bay Area Women's Summit, I was very proud of that summit and proud for the city because it got us committed to doing more. And if there's any area we could do more, it's promoting and advancing women's rights, family issues, more of our affordability for our city, and certainly announcing more women heading up city government and the private sector as well. I know all of you know that the disappointment of last November is still with us, and it seems like every day there's a kind of a new attack that we have to deal with, and whether it's attack on our neighbors or our families or our friends or the values that this country is built on. But I also think something good is coming out, and yesterday was yet another example, and today here's another example, and that is that it's given us the drive that we needed to have. I didn't think anything good would come out of this, but I do and am recognizing that when we are challenged, the good of people all over our city and all over the country and the region is coming out. It's coming out more deliberately and more intentionally, and it allows us to fight together for the good things that we believe in. I think our city, certainly I know our board is, and I know Supervisor Centrifuge, she feels the energy that's going on at the board level. It happens to be led by women, so that might be part of the reason it's so energized. But I also think our region and our country is being energized. People are looking for ways to participate, do what they can to make sure that our country moves forward and not backward. And in the Bay Area, we know a thing or two about social change, and we've led the way with guaranteed parental leave, guaranteed sick leave, affordable health care for all, and we've certainly pushed out the minimum wage as quickly as we can, highest in the nation, and an act that will really help working families and certainly mothers. We've been building our commitment to provide access to education, and as I've said earlier, I'm so proud of creating a college savings account for all San Franciscans, right from the kindergarten all the way to college. That's one of the proudest programs that I think this city has been on the map for, and so many other cities are following that example. They were going from awe, how did you do that, to we can do it too. And this year, of course, we've doubled down, and I'm very proud to have worked with Supervisor Kim on making sure our city college is free to our San Francisco residents. That's something that you're going to see a lot of benefit. You should see the ideas that are coming out of Free City College. And I think all of you know here, that since our Bay Area Women's Summit commitment that we made, dedicated $16.7 million to fund initiatives that support San Francisco families. We've included $6 million for subsidized childcare, $10 million to fight violence against women, particularly for intervention programs. Proud of that. And we're expanding our implicit bias all at the same time. I know there's going to be a lot of tech companies that follow our example. And, you know, this work goes well beyond just announcing new policies and funding. Our region, our economy, and our workplaces do benefit whenever we position women to succeed. And we'll continue that by example. We'll continue that with programs that promote and advance women's equity, empowerment, and opportunity. And I'm proud to say this, that many of you in this room, whether you're a commissioner, you're a department head, or you're being honored in the private sector, or you're leading our nonprofits, you know that 60% of our city's government workforce, that's 30,000 people working for the city and county of San Francisco, more if you add all the nonprofits that we contract, 60% are led and make up, are made by women in the workforce. That is a tremendous example. So I think we must have promoted some women, because yesterday was 58% in my notes. Don't think I didn't notice that. Public relations people. It jumped up to 60% overnight. We must have hired a lot of people overnight. Must have been that fire department. But I'm also proud that I lead by example, because in our city government, and in the mayor's office in particular, we are 61% women. And so that city department is leading the effort. You know, I get to go around promoting where our women are serving in leadership positions in the city. Highest and most valued departments, including our city administrator, of course, our fire department, Department of Emergency Management, our health department, our port director, Department of Environment, Human Rights, Human Resources, so many departments, OCC, so many departments I'm proud of. 311, we're just celebrating 10 years, right? It's been led for 10 years by a woman. I mean, these are critical, important agency departments of our city, and I'm very proud that they're being headed by women. And of course, I mentioned earlier, for the first time in 21 years, the majority of our representatives on our Board of Supervisors are women, and of course, led by President London Breed. Thank you for making sure women are leading that effort as well. So in early March, I had the honor of recognizing 8 women who are moving our city forward through the Department of City of the Status of Women's Women Making History Awards. And these are, of course, leaders who are improving the quality of life for all of San Franciscans, who've made it their mission to advance equality in labor and business. But ultimately, they come down, they're just fine human beings that I'm also giving an award to. They're great leaders in their own right. So I want to take a minute to recognize the women by asking you to really help us by standing up when I announce you, because you are doing fantastic things for the city, for the region, and for the country. Let's begin with Kate Kendall, the Executive Director of the National Center for Lesbian Rights. Kate, are you here? Okay. Well, Kate's been a good example. Another good friend, one that I've got the privilege of working very close with the last couple of years, because I've been trying to make sure she builds housing on some sites as she leads some of the hardest working people in our city. Olga Miranda, the president, SEIU, Local 87, our janitors union. Thank you, Olga. Thank you. In the private sector, heading up the venture partner at 500 Startups, Monique Woodard. Thank you, Monique, for being here. You're part of our recognition. The CEO of Caravan Studios, Marnie Webb. Congratulations, Marnie. Okay, maybe he's on the way. Someone that I've had a personal privilege of working for many, many years, if not a few decades in the city, and she's now heading up as the executive director, the Haas Family Fund, Pam David. Pam. All right. Someone else who I worked with very intensely the last year, but she's been working very hard for a few years as our police commission. She is now the assistant chief legal counsel for our sheriff's department, Susie Loftus. You know, in Chinatown, we also celebrate history as we also remind people, and more, it's been more important to remind our national leaders about the history of many parts of our country. And of course, she heads up the Chinese Historical Society as its director, Sue Lee. Thank you, Sue, and congratulations. And then, you know, I'm pretty proud. I didn't think I'd ever say this, but I'm kind of proud of lawyers these days because lawyers are doing it for us. When we need our viewpoints argued in court, when we need them to do pro bono work, need them to represent more people, whether it's at immigration or in the courts, they've been there. And I'm very proud to have selected our executive director and general counsel and the Bar Association of San Francisco, Yolanda Jackson. Thank you. Well, all of you, from the backgrounds, from your titles, from where you work, I'm very proud of each and every one of you for the outstanding work and your commitment to our city and to our communities. Thank you all, and I know that change does not happen on its own. And I know that it takes all of us working together. And this is something that I've had many discussions with each and every one of you. I never want you to work alone. And in fact, the exciting thing in working in San Francisco is you get to work with each other. You get to work with people that you didn't think cared about what you do, whether it's in your department or in your commission or in your private sector or in your nonprofits. And what we think, I think what we do the best is we break down those barriers, work more as a collaborative city, and that's how we improve the conditions and opportunities for women in our city and in women in our region. And there's always more things to do. That's why I'm excited to announce that alongside last year, as you know, I joined Mayor Libby Schaaf to do this Bay Area Women's Summit. This year, we're going to add in Mayor Liccardo from San Jose, and all three of us. Yes, the whole region is going to be united around our Bay Area Women's Summit. We have a date. We finally have a specific date, and the date is for our next Bay Area Women's Summit is Tuesday, June 19th, 2018, at our own Moscone West. And I'm happy to announce that the summit is in good hands. We have a date. We have two co-chairs, and I want to make sure you know them. Of course, our City Administrator Naomi Kelly is coming back because she had so much fun. And Debbie Meslow is joining us as a co-chair. And she is, of course, we all know Debbie. She's been the vice president of our Commission on the Status of Women, longtime senior advisor to the Senator Kamala Harris. I think we have a senator that might be coming then, huh? If not more than one. So they'll serve as the 2018 co-chairs. I think is in great hands, so I won't have to worry about it. But I know that the 2016 was a success because we all came together. We all recognized the contributions that people were making, and we all wanted more opportunities for women and girls in our city and in our region. So I am looking forward to building on the success of last year and discussing how to continue greater opportunities, having those critical conversations that we need to have to make sure that leaders, that we have more leaders to push for equality and pave the way for the rest of our country, more examples, more conversations, just like we had with Secretary Clinton yesterday. That was, I think, aspirational and enthusiastic. This means that there'll be a lot of work ahead for all of us, but it'll be good work. It'll be work that we'll enjoy. And tonight, I want to join all of you in celebrating your accomplishments, keeping the city strong, making sure that we're moving together, and to know that you'll have a mayor, at least for the next 3 years, and you have department heads that we've well-placed, you have commissioners, you have nonprofits that we're helping, but you have a strong city that will back women's rights up, make sure we are family-friendly, let's build more housing so that people can be here as affordability, let's get more people not living on our streets, and let's make sure that equality and opportunity and progress is made in everything that we do. Congratulations, have fun tonight, let's celebrate, and let's get to work together to make sure more opportunities are there. Congratulations.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. So up next, I thought we'd have a quick panel discussion with some very dynamic ladies who I would like to introduce to you. First is our moderator, Surina Khan, and Surina has been such a partner. She is the CEO of the Women's Foundation of California, and we partner with the Women's Foundation to put on the 2016 Bay Area Women's Summit, and she has agreed, and we're going to partner again for 2018. So thank you for that, Surina. But why don't you come on up? Surina, for over two decades, she has been the leader in philanthropic and nonprofit social justice sector, starting with the local community-based publishing in New England, and then shifting to national and global work on an array of social justice issues, including women's rights, LGBT rights, and human rights. Next, we have up our panelists and one of the mayor's awardees for Women's History Month, Olga Miranda. And Olga, please come to the stage. Olga is president of SEIU Local 87, the janitors union in San Francisco. She is also secretary treasurer of the San Francisco Labor Council. And for many years, she has directed a pioneering collaboration with the Labor Community Studies Department at City College of San Francisco. Next up is panelist Catherine Stefani. Catherine, come on up. Catherine is an attorney who began her legal career as a prosecutor in Contra Costa County, who now serves as our own San Francisco County Clerk, and has served on the board of directors of a homeless prenatal program, and is now the local chapter leader and spokesperson for Moms Demand Action for Gun Sense in America. And finally, but not least, Buffy Wicks. Buffy, please come on up. Buffy is a political strategist and grassroots organizer. She served on the senior staff of President Obama's 2008 and 2012 campaigns and as deputy director for the White House Office of Public Engagement. Buffy was a fellow at the Institute of Politics and Public Policy at Georgetown University and a senior fellow at the Center for American Progress, where she focused on public policies affecting women and families. Buffy also hosts a feminist podcast called The Riveters, so you should check that out. So I'm going to turn over the panel to Surina, who will moderate, and I'm looking forward to this riveting discussion.
Great. Thank you so much, and thank you all for being here. Again, my name is Surina Khan. I'm the CEO of the Women's Foundation of California. So happy to be partnering with the city again on the next Bay Area Women's Summit. We were a proud partner for 2016, and we can't wait for the next one. And I'm particularly happy to be here tonight because the Women's Foundation of California got its start right here in San Francisco in 1979. So we're almost 40 years old, and in that time we've granted out almost $40 million to organizations in the Bay Area. Now across the state, we've grown to be a statewide Women's Foundation, but we started right here in San Francisco. So it's really a pleasure to be here tonight and to moderate this panel with this amazing group of people. Our theme for this evening is civic engagement, about how we can all think about getting more involved. We are really actually staring at a moment in history in our lifetimes where we have the opportunity to engage more people than perhaps we have ever been able to. We've seen it here in San Francisco in the streets. We've seen it at the protests at SFO and across the country. And so it's a real opportunity, I think, to engage people. And we want to build on what we did at the Bay Area Women's Summit. That was, as you heard the mayor and Naomi Kelly say, that wasn't a one-time event. We want to follow it with policy initiatives. We saw thousands of people who attended make individual pledges, and they wanted to know, there were some themes that emerged from those about, how do I get more involved? How do I get mentorship so that I can get involved and make a difference? How can I resist? How can we protect the gains that we've made, and how can we continue to make advancements, particularly because we are here in the Bay Area, we are here in California, and we have an opportunity to showcase some hope for the rest of the country, because we will be able to continue making advancements for gender equality, for racial justice, for economic justice, and so it's both our responsibility and our opportunity. So with that, I want to start us off on a personal note, and I want to ask each of our panelists about what inspired you, who or what inspired you to get involved in a life of civic engagement. So I'm going to start with Olga.
I think everybody's heard of a Dolores Huerta or the inspiring image of Rosie the Riveter. For me, it was Mauricia Flores, and that's my mother. She was an indigenous woman from Nayarit. She didn't know how to read or write, and somehow she still made it. She wanted something greater for her kids, and she immigrated to the United States, not knowing how to read or write, did not stop her from fighting for fair housing from our community, from being removed from our home. And she helped a lot of Latinos get elected in Los Angeles. And our Saturdays, our weekends, were going out in precinct walking and translating at City Hall in Los Angeles and writing the letters that 8 or 9 year olds should not be writing to electeds about why it is we deserve fair housing. That's been always been my inspiration. There's a lot of women in San Francisco whose names we don't know but have done incredible things for all of us here in the city, and not just within labor but within the private sector as well. And I'm incredibly humbled to be up here amongst all of you. All of you are warriors in your own respective ways, and I appreciate you all being here with us today. Thank you.
Great, thank you so much. Buffy, let me turn to you actually in terms of your, we heard your amazing bio and the many things that you've done, particularly recently and for many years. So how about you? What,
sure.
What or who inspired you?
So I'm from a little town near Lake Tahoe called Forest Hill, which no one ever knows where it's at. Some of you may. And actually I was living in San Francisco in early 2002, 2003, and I was really moved into action during the lead up to the war in Iraq. And I started organizing in the anti-war movement here in San Francisco. And I was one of the women with the bullhorn leading people down the streets, shutting down the streets of San Francisco. And I'll tell you a little bit, just a quick story that kind of highlights, I think, my appreciation for organizing, because my background's in organizing. So it was leading up to the war in Iraq, and I was driving to work one day, and a good friend of mine and my roommate at the time, a guy named Tom, called me and said, I just tested positive with HIV. Can you pick me up from the clinic? So I went to the clinic, it was in the Mission District, and I sat down with him and the nurse, and I learned about T-cell counts and viral loads and things that I didn't know that much about at the time. And we left the clinic he was at, and we got into my car, and I remember it was kind of a cloudy day, and he turned to me and said, I don't have any health insurance. And in his biggest moment of need, he was worried about his insurance and not his actual health. And this was the week that we started dropping bombs in Iraq. And I got really angry at the direction our country was going. And I decided right then and there I wanted to work on health reform, and I wanted to have a seat at the table, or as close to a seat at the table that I could when we were making these decisions as a country. And that set me on a trajectory to get much more involved in national politics. I shortly thereafter met a guy, state senator named Barack Obama from Illinois. And I worked for a labor union fighting for better health care for Walmart workers. And then in early 2007, I had the opportunity to move to Chicago and work for Barack Obama, who was running for president. And I helped to develop our organizing strategy, and we actually pioneered that here in California. I was the field director for Barack Obama here in California against Hillary back in the day, where we learned how to take social movement organizing, a lot of which from the labor movement, and apply it to an electoral context. So I worked for him on the campaign, and then I had the opportunity to work for him in the White House, and I worked on the Affordable Care Act. So I spent the first 15 months of the administration working on that, and I'll never forget on a Sunday evening in March of 2010, sitting in the Roosevelt Room with the President of the United States and the Vice President and the senior staff, watching the votes come in on the Affordable Care Act. And when that last vote came in, I realized, as the crowd erupted and everyone jumped up and the President started giving people hugs, that my friend Tom wouldn't be considered a pre-existing condition anymore. And I also realized the power of organizing, that many of us spent decades working to get that bill passed through many different administrations, and that if we worked together with a focus, a laser-like focus, and a passion and a true understanding as to why we are doing the work that we are doing, we can achieve great things.
Thank you so much. That's so moving. Thank you for sharing that. That is just incredibly moving, and so many people have healthcare thanks to your work. So really appreciate that you shared that with us. So I'm going to move on to Catherine now, our fearless county clerk. What is it that you know? You recently you were active in starting the organization around opposing gun violence in schools, and you mentioned that it came from the tragedy that happened at Sandy Hook in my home state of Connecticut. So tell us about, you know, whether it was that incident or what was it that really inspired you in a life in civic, in public service?
Thank you. Yes, you know, I'd always been involved in the gun violence prevention movement since Columbine. I was working as an attorney at the time, and I had a little legal call-in show called For the Record on Contra Costa Television. And I was just so disturbed about what happened at Columbine that I had a show called Gun Control, and I had someone from the Coalition to Stop Gun Violence and someone from the NRA. And at that time, I was just flabbergasted at what our laws were then, and I kind of went after the NRA person a lot and really realized I was never going to be a journalist because I could not be impartial in that situation. But then, you know, then Aurora happened, and then I did some pro bono legal work for the Law Center to Prevent Gun Violence. And again, just I couldn't believe, you know, what happened at Aurora. And then the day of Sandy Hook, I could barely talk about this without getting too emotional. I had just dropped off birthday snacks to my son's second grade classroom. He's actually sitting back there. And so I was in his classroom that morning, and I got in my car. I started driving here to City Hall. I worked for Supervisor Farrell at the time. And I started hearing the reports of what happened. And I just could not believe it. And I knew in that moment that every day of the rest of my life, I had to spend time and effort at changing our lax gun laws in this country. And thank God, a woman named Shannon Watt started a Facebook page, and it was called 1 Million Moms for Gun Control at the time, and then we changed it to Moms Demand Action for Gun Sense in America. And what we wanted to do was become what Mothers Against Drunk Driving did for drunk, our drunk driving laws for gun laws in this country. We have a chapter in every state. We have about 3.5 million members. We've merged with Michael Bloomberg, Mayor Bloomberg, with Every Town for Gun Safety, and I'm the local group leader here in San Francisco, and what we do, we resist, we persist, I think, what did she say? Insist. Do you realize it's RIPE? Like, we're ripe for change? It's like an acronym. It's an old law school thing. It stands for RIPE. And we enlist. We have grown our chapter so much. I have 12 local group leaders. And, you know, every day it's about what can we do to push back the NRA's agenda of guns everywhere for everyone anytime in this country.
Terrific. Thank you so much. What a great start to this panel. So we all know there's many ways to be civically engaged, so I want to turn actually to the audience now and just ask, you know, some of you clearly are in public office, but for those of you that aren't, how many of you have ever been inspired or thought about running for office? If you could just raise your hand. Okay, we got to work on that. And how many of you have been to a protest march? Okay. How many have engaged in some kind of policy advocacy, whether it's calling a legislator or... Terrific. Okay, so let me ask, you know, I'm sure all of you have been asked I have many times, this question of, I really want to do something after the November election. I want to do something. I want to get involved. What can I do? How do I plug in? So I'm sure many of you have gotten that response to that question, and I'm wondering what are some of your responses? So let's start with Catherine.
Well, I tell people you can't give up. It's not always easy to get into an organization. Even when I was trying to get involved with Moms Demand Action, you know, it was a young group, and you know, I just kept trying. I kept calling. I couldn't make an event. I'd call again, and finally someone called me back, and then I got invited to DC, and I started to meet people in the organization, and I just kept going back and going back and going back. I didn't wait for someone to ask me. I asked them, and you just have to not be afraid to keep trying to break into the organization you want to be in, involved with, and not worry about what other people think. You know, a lot of people say to me all the time, aren't you embarrassed or aren't you worried about, you know, about all your advocacy on social media? Because and I'm like, no, not at all. It's something that I am not afraid to do. And so you just have to go after it with all of your passion.
Yep, great. And Olga, you're an organizer. Clearly you started very young in terms of organizing your community. So that can be intimidating for a lot of people. You know, they say, I want to get involved, but I don't think I can be an organizer. I want to get involved, but, you know, there's so many different ways to get involved. So do you have, you know, do you have suggestions for people? Some people might have time. Some people might have organizing skills. Some people might have, you know, artistic abilities or extra money that they can give. What are some ways that you think people can be involved?
You know, the members that I represent, the workers that I represent, were shocked at the results of the elections. But when you are directly affected, you don't have the luxury to feel bad about for that continuously. A lot of folks took the luxury of having a hangover after the elections. But for the Muslim members I represent, it was dead on that we needed to see what else we needed to do. Not shocked, but hurt. And not injured, but it rose us to make sure that we continue to fight. The women, immigrant families that we represent at our local, we don't have time to take a day off of work to just take it all in. We need those hours in order to qualify for health insurance for our babies. We need that 7.5 hours of work in order to pay the rent that's already too high. But on top of being deported, on top of being banned from my family being reunited at the airport, the families I represent every day don't have the luxury to analyze it and overanalyze it. We have to prepare and have a plan B, literally a plan B. What will happen to my baby should I be picked up? My mother, who was a single mother with 10 kids, never really allowed for us kids to have free time. It's unheard of in a Mexican household. If you're bored, you wash the dishes. If nobody wants to play with you, you go organize the bathroom and whatever's in the bathroom. But for single mothers out there who really raise their children to push themselves as hard as they can, for myself, the consideration of running for office, you know, has never really crossed my mind. As perhaps those people who are brave enough to raise their hands. For me, it's always been about how do I raise my community? How do we push ourselves, for all of us, to understand each other? Being from LA, we're very segregated. So when I came to the Bay Area, it was very culture shock getting out of a car at Berkeley. Was very culture shocked with all the dynamic, different nationalities around us. But poor people and working families don't have the luxury to overthink things. We have to struggle to get by, make ends meet, and hope to God that tomorrow we'll be able to still open the same damn door that's always being pushed against us. We encourage all of our members to sign up to become citizens every day. In our union hall, nothing can be published if it's not in four languages. It's an insult if it's not in Arabic, Spanish, Chinese. For us, it's a necessity to vote and use that power of the vote. A lot of our members, because they come from other countries, the vote had no meaning, had no power. But it's also injurious to our members with the results of the elections and how much our union pushed them to go out and vote. At least for California, we won. But for our members in DC, we lost. And again, we encourage every one of our members to not sit on the fence of being a resident for a long time. We ask them to come to community meetings. We ask them to attend to picket lines and marches. But the struggle isn't just a thing that's in DC. A struggle for the members I represent is every time there's a knock on the door, who is it? Who is it? So I hope I answered your question.
You did. Thank you so much. Thank you. So, Buffy, I want to turn to you and ask you sort of along this theme about getting involved. People are feeling an urgency, and so there's a need to, you know, think about all the short-term needs that we have and the attacks that we're facing, whether we're, you know, like myself, a first-generation immigrant, a lesbian, a woman of color, a Muslim. I'm originally born in Pakistan. And so I've started carrying my passport around with me, which just... feels terrible. And I don't plan on leaving the country, not that I had any big plans to do much international travel this year, but I will be turning 50, and I thought I might go celebrate in Mexico, but honestly, I'm reconsidering that. So in terms of these sort of short-term issues, and I will, you know, say all of that with the privilege that I have to live in this beautiful city, to have this amazing job, but there's... We all want to do something for the short term to protect, you know, the people who are being deported, who are being separated from their kids, who risk losing health insurance. And so how do you balance the short-term need with the long-term Yeah. vision that we need to continue to have?
Well, I'm very inspired by what I see happening across the country, not just in the Bay Area, but all across the country, of this new energized resistance movement that's coming up, that's happening right now. And, you know, I went to the Women's March in D.C. after the inaugural. I was in D.C. I was there with my, at the time, two-month-old daughter, so she went to her first march protest. And I was inspired because I realized, so I'm an organizer, I'm a professional organizer. I've organized, you know, in the Obama campaign, I organized in the Clinton campaign. And at that march, I realized that, A, it was incredibly diverse, which I loved and which was great. And it was in D.C. I don't know if it was all over the country, but in certain parts of the country, I think it was pretty diverse here, Oakland and other parts of the Bay Area, which was great. But the other thing that I was inspired by was that none of the sort of professional class of organizers in the Obama world or the Clinton world were involved in it. It was truly an organic time where some women put something up on Facebook and said, we have to resist, we have to persist. And millions of people showed up. And that to me is really exciting. That reaction, that was our welcome to Donald Trump when he came in on his first day, was just very, very empowering. And so I'm excited about seeing a lot of that. In terms of what I think people can do, I think there's a number of things. You know, we live in California, we live in the Bay Area. Obviously, Democrats up and down, very progressive part of the world, probably one of the most progressive parts of the world, frankly. And so I think sometimes we feel like, well, the battle's not really happening here, right? It's happening in Ohio, or it's happening in Colorado, or it's happening in a targeted congressional district or a targeted, you know, presidential battleground state. I think we feel like that sometimes. But the truth of the matter is I think there's a lot you can do here in California. One, at the federal level, it's important for Nancy Pelosi and Dianne Feinstein and Kamala Harris, our friend Kamala, all of them to hear about how you view the things that are happening. They need the backup. They need to say on the floor of the Senate or the floor of the House, my constituents are calling me and they're telling me to vote yes or no on this thing, right? That gives them the power to go do that. So even if we know that there's a sort of safe votes on a lot of these federal issues, it's important that they hear from us. At the state level, you know, we're lucky that we live in, I think, one of the sort of last functioning democracies of the United States, right? We can pass laws here in California. We can pass progressive legislation. And so helping out on those state races and those state issue advocacy campaigns, I think, is also important because we can do really innovative work here at the municipal and state level and pilot that for the rest of the country. And we can be a model for how progressive policies can help working families in this country. So I think it's really important for us to do the issue advocacy work at the state level as well. And I think most importantly, what are the issues that drive you? What do you care about? Is it gun violence prevention? You know, is it health reform? What is the thing, and how do you tie that to your own personal experiences? Because you care about those things from your own personal experiences, right? So tapping into that energy and that passion and saying, okay, how am I going to translate that into real energy? What's the organization that I'm going to really put time and effort into? Am I going to donate? Am I going to give my time? Am I going to give what other resources that I have to help? And really honing in on, I think, that strength within yourself and that understanding within yourself of why you're motivated. Why are you motivated to be in this room today? You don't have to be here. It's a nice day. You could go join a happy hour right now. You know, but you're here for a reason because you care about something. So understanding what that is and really honing in on that and then putting that energy to an organization or an issue that you care about, I think, is the most important thing.
Thank you. That really leads me into my next question, and I'm going to ask Catherine. This sort of the local versus the national, so you're with an organization that has chapters, you said, in every state. So you're working on a sort of national level, but in a very localized way. And so what we've seen in the last several months is that people have really opened up their pocketbooks and made, you know, considerable generosity in terms of the donations that have been made. We saw, I mean, the ACLU raised since the election, I think it's like $50 million, and over in one weekend it was like $27 million, I think, after the inauguration. So just in one weekend. And so, you know, it's easy to give to organizations like the ACLU because we know them so well. They're a brand that we recognize. It's easy to write a check to Planned Parenthood because we see that Planned Parenthood is under attack, and you know, we again recognize Planned Parenthood as a name. But how do you balance that in terms of the local activism and local giving for organizations that are really, in many cases, more in need because they don't have the fundraising capacity. They might not be well known because they don't have the visibility, and yet they are the ones that are, you know, helping to keep families together. They are the ones that are, you know, organizing the protests at the airport. So how do you balance that need between kind of local and national when it comes to giving?
I think what you do is you build coalitions. You reach out to other organizations that care about the same things that you do. And I know with Moms Demand Action, we reach out to the local Brady chapter, to United Playas, to Gun by Gun, and we do a lot of things together. We did a Golden Gate Bridge March on June 2nd. And really getting to know the people in those organizations and understanding their needs and partnering with them. And we all care about the same thing. And with Moms Demand Action, we invite others to get behind like what we do at the federal level, like challenging our concealed carry reciprocity law that's been introduced that could demand that all states take concealed carry permits from all over the country, which would completely strip California of the gun laws that we have on our books. And so you just build coalitions, and I donate to Gun by Gun, I work with Gun by Gun, I work with Rudy at United Playas, I do whatever I can to build those coalitions and educate them about what we're doing, and they educate us about what they're doing, and I think that's one good way to balance it.
Great. And then I want to turn now to kind of the opportunity that we have before us to really build power in California. We are lucky to live here. We have amazing organizations and activism that is happening here. We have incredible political leadership from the local level to the state level. And so how do we take all of those assets that we have in this particular political moment where people are really wanting to get involved and further build those coalitions, you know, strengthen community organizing and really take the opportunity that we have before us to do base building in a really meaningful way. And I'll just offer one example from the Women's Foundation, which is that 14 years ago we heard from state legislators that said, you know, we're not really hearing from your grant partners on any policy issues. Why is that? And so we took that question really seriously, and we did kind of a landscape analysis, and basically because we're funding low-income communities, communities of color, these are grassroots leaders that really didn't have the skills to engage in policy advocacy. So we started a Women's Policy Institute that's now in its 14th year. We've trained upwards of now, we're getting up to about almost 500 women leaders and trans people who have been trained through the institute. It's an experiential institute, so they go through, they have to come up with a policy idea, they work in teams based on, you know, different issue areas, and they have to find an author and run their bill through the state legislature. And it's a training program, but one of the unanticipated wonderful outcomes has been that 29 of those policy projects have been signed into law. So for example, you would recognize the Domestic Worker Bill of Rights that Governor Brown signed into permanent law earlier this year. That came out of the institute. So it's kind of this incredible, you know, achievements and accomplishments that have happened, but more importantly is that it's a network of, you know, almost 500 people, each of whom are connected to a constituency base. So potentially we can activate millions of people just through this one network. So I'm curious about what are some other ways that you see in this particular moment to build power in California so that we can continue to make advancements here, but also be a model for other parts of the country. So I'm going to start with Olga.
For us, we organize a little bit differently, our union and how it is we work. We work in coalition with a lot of pro-immigrant organizations, student organizations at the campuses where we represent janitors. But we organize out of mosques. We organize out of our Chinatown Business Association with our janitors, who also happen to have businesses that they're entrepreneurs. We organize in the apartment buildings where a lot of our members live. But there's an opportunity right now that it's the children of our members that are leading their parents on the fights that are going on. And it's been really inspiring because it's their high school students, their children who are in college, that are educating their parents a little bit more on Bernie Sanders. A lot of our members had no idea. Everybody knew who Hillary Clinton was. None of our members knew 4 or 5 years ago who Bernie Sanders was. But our members' children educated their parents on why they should vote for him. And the type of political organizing that our members do is, you know, we endorse, we question, and we challenge different policies here at City Hall. But this, what these elections have done for all of us is that there's a huge resurgence. And it's not the parents telling the kids. It's really the kids that are leading this, and they're inspiring us, especially for those of our members whose children happen to be DACA recipients and the fear of all of that. But they're leading their parents into these fights and why they're so important to get involved locally. Healthcare is a huge issue for our members and their families. Members were willing to go on strike. And I just, you know, I understand he left, but I want to be able to give recognize the mayor in the support that he lent our janitors. We were about to go on strike. Our members had voted to go on strike last summer, and it was for health insurance, not wages, not pension. It was the health insurance that our members were willing to go on strike for. And this, there's a saying in Spanish, no hay mal que por bien no venga. There isn't a bad that won't bring a good. And this bad has really brought a huge, inspiring movement of young people, of our members' children, to encourage their parents to become citizens. But what we can all do is ask, just like you mentioned. It's important that we have something that we're passionate about and attached to it. And if there's something that you are interested in doing, come and join a meeting with us, with any of the families that we represent. If you're interested, trust me, if you see a rat and a huge picket line, just join us. We're all over the city in San Francisco.
Great, thank you. So I want to ask Buffy one question, then we're going to wrap up with our calls to action. So Buffy, I mean, you worked on a monumental piece of legislation that this country has not been able to do for decades, if not centuries, really. Even with a lot of effort and trying by so many amazing, legislators that came before President Obama. So what are some lessons learned that we can, what did you learn? What is some advice that you would give to people who are organizing now for big wins?
Yeah, so I think when we passed the Affordable Care Act, a lot of what had happened is sort of the right moment, right time, right president, right Congress, and we were able to very painstakingly get that piece of legislation through. What was really, really important was the strength of the outside advocacy organizations. And I worked for Valerie Jarrett. I was the deputy director of the White House Office of Public Engagement. And so my job was to mobilize the outside advocacy organizations. And they, of course, there was definitely a whole debate around single payer. Some people are disappointed in the bill. Obviously, I think we wanted to get as far left as we possibly could, but we needed to cut a deal in the end of the day. And so that's what we kind of came out with. But it was really, really, really important that we had that left flank pulling us to the left. You really need that. And I think sometimes we forget that when we're like, oh, President Obama's the president. Like, we don't need to be as strong on the left because we have the guy in office. But it's so critical that that left flank is there and is strong and is in his ear. And I think the same thing can be said here with state politics here. You need that left flank at the municipal level and at the state level in order to pull the public policy that way. Because the right is certainly pulling. And they're going to pull. So we have to have that same level of activity and engagement. And I think the one thing we're realizing now, when you look at the deck that we have, the hand that we have in terms of cards, we don't have the presidency, we don't have the House, we don't have the Senate, we don't have two-thirds of the state legislatures, we don't have two-thirds of the state Secretary of States, we don't have two-thirds of the governorships in this country. So the Democratic Party, what we realized when we lost, I think, federally, is that it was crumbling beneath us, right? At the state level, we were really suffering. So I think it's really important for us to focus on those state races, rebuild the party from the ground up, have a strong left flank. I think we have the opportunity here in California, like I said earlier, to model progressive progressive legislation that we could take other places. And my hope is that we will be a phoenix rising from the ashes as a party here in this country. On the left side, we're seeing this level of energy and engagement all across the country. And we'll be able to rebuild our party from a truly kind of progressive point of view moving forward.
Great, thank you. Well, now we're going to wrap up because I can see that the food is being delivered over to that table, and we're standing between you and a wonderful bar full of wine back there. So we want to have time to engage with each other and network. So my final question to each of you is, what is one call to action that you would give to this community that's with us tonight, but also to others around the state and the country? One call to action.
Sure. I think my call to action is if you're a woman, consider running for office or find another woman to run for office. All I can think about is what office can Olga run for right now. And, you know, we are vastly underrepresented in the United States in terms of female representation in all offices. We're 104th in the world for women represented in national legislatures behind Mexico, Pakistan, China. So find a woman to run for office, or if you're a woman, run yourself, and I'm gonna get you to run.
Olga for America.
Yes. You've got my vote, Olga. What's your, well, we know what your call to action is, so.
It's that obvious, huh? The positions that you have within City Hall, you guys are movers and shakers. You get to decide how the door is opened in your respective departments, how people are treated with respect. And I understand we all work hard. We have two shifts for the women in the room. We have our morning shift that starts at 5 to 8 when we send our kids to work. Then we have our real jobs, the paying job. Then we have our third shift when we come home. Stand with those women and brothers that have come to your doors, to your departments. Treat them with respect. Some of them have felt that the doors aren't that wide when they're coming in because of their backs, their language barriers. I highly encourage every one of you that when they come through your doors, that you welcome them. This is the only city, one of the few cities in the country, that everybody has been included. But I want to just remind you, I know we're tired and your staffs may be tired of their long days. But how we treat people when they're coming through your department doors sends a really strong message about the kind of city that we want to have, that we want to have personified on a national level, that we want people to be that example of what a city and how a city should run. You have those doors. You sit in those positions. And somebody saw a light in every one of you about why you should be that department head. So I ask every one of you to challenge your staff, to remind them. Even a smile when you're not feeling the lady to want to smile. But it sends a huge message about how people will come to your departments and how they should be treated. And I also want to make a call to every one of you. Lead by example. On May Day, this May Day will be the first May Day that we are doing with this administration. As department heads, I challenge every one of you to encourage your staff to attend any action that will start from 7:30 in the morning all the way to the evening time. And in San Francisco, we will be marching. Come out and have your lunch with us. Join us. Don't reprimand your staff. Lead by example. This city is immigrants. This city is all about how we raise, how women make the city run. So I ask every one of you to please join us. Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Olga. And Buffy, what's your call to action?
Sure. So women are in the forefront of social change in this country. You know, on the Obama campaign, our core volunteers that were leading our campaigns all across the country, 71% were women. The president won on the backs of women. You know, when you look at Moms Demand Action, when you look at the Mothers Against Drunk Driving, when you look at the resistance movement, what kicked off the resistance movement? The Women's March. You know, you look at the Civil Rights Movement, women were leading it, but often were overshadowed by the men. So I have a lot of faith of the people in this room, and my ask would be, pick the thing that you care most about, get involved with an organization at the local level, be agents of change in that, and really commit yourself to it, whether it's choice, whether it's gun violence, whether it's clean energy, clean water. All of these things are under attack right now with this administration, and it is our moral obligation to stand up to this president.
Thank you so much. And before we wrap up, I'm just going to offer my own call to action. I work in philanthropy, so my call to action is give local. Find an organization that's local, that you care about, and give to them. And give towards gender equity, because when the Women's Foundation started in 1979, only 1% of all philanthropic dollars were going specifically to women's and girls' issues. Now, almost 40 years later, we've moved the needle, but only to somewhere between 7 and 9%. And that is not nearly enough for the inequities that we see around gender. So I ask you to be philanthropic and to give to your local organization. And if you need help identifying one, the Women's Foundation of California is here to partner with you and direct you to where you want to give. So please join me in thanking our panelists and Naomi Kelly and the city.
Wow, okay, I was definitely inspired by all four of you ladies, and thank you so much. I mean, the call to action, I was just thinking, what could we do? And there's so much we can do right now. And I love Olga for America. I love opening the doors for all those department and commission heads, opening doors for all the women and families who come to our doors, lead by example, May Day, and pick an issue and become an advocate for that issue. I love all of that and give locally. Love it. All right, so one last thing. I'm gonna have Debbie come up, Meslo, my partner in crime in all this, and close out remarks. But for the 2018 Women's Summit, there's many, many issues that we could discuss. And so we have back there John Caldone and Jillian Johnson. If you have ideas or issues that you want discussed at the 2018 Women's Summit, please come see them. Write a note, because we are taking all your suggestions, and we'll be shaping our panel discussions and our workshops around ideas that we get and feedback that we get during this time period. So Debbie, Meslo to close out, and then we get to food and drinks.
Thanks, Naomi. And I just wanted to say it was so inspirational to hear the panel and to hear all of Mayor Lee's commitments and how the city is honoring those. And I just think right now coming together as a community is so powerful. I look out in this room and so many people that I've had the privilege of working with, in particular the Commission on the Status of Women, all the commissioners that are here, our president and the lead of our department, as well as commission staff. And I just put a plug in for the Bay Area Women's Summit next year. We had a great time last time. If you had a chance to attend, please do fill out the and go up to the wall with what you'd like to see. We will shape the program around that. And now I think we'll have some wine and some food. So thank you.